but the principle remains same. So what we are going to study here will be useful to many of you, because you will be going to the diverse field, and some of you may be looking after the EMUs when you get posted as CMEs, where this motor is used. So only one or two slides I will show you, where something about EMU is connected, not directly but indirectly. It is because of this that you people will be going as a, some of you at least will be going as CME. And now CME looks after, but days to come, I don't know, maybe more responsibilities may come to mechanical department. So the knowledge of three-phase traction motor will be really useful. Having said that, let me tell you, the DC traction motor which we have been using was really good. You will see it now. And let us see the historical background of this motor. Historical background is needed to understand the how the three-phase technology came and why we have gone for three-phase traction motor, and what is the use of three-phase technology, and how DC was giving good service to us. This so history will indicate that briefly. Again, let me tell you, this three-phase technology has not come from electrical loco to diesel loco. It is other way around. First, a diesel locomotive of three-phase technology was developed, and then it has gone to the electrical locomotives throughout the world, not in India, throughout the world. So we should thank diesel locomotive for introducing this technology for the world. Now, as you know, the electrical power got developed as a DC. DC is really a very simple technology, and mathematically also and technologically also, understanding wise also, the person who was associated closely with it was Thomas Alva Edison. He was not a very educated type of person, so not very proficient in mathematics. So for him, the DC was the ultimate thing. Nothing can be more than that. That's what he thought. That's how the DC got developed. And when DC got developed, naturally generator has to come. So the generator came. And DC generator is nothing but a motor also. You give the supply to that generator, it works as a motor. So the development of DC motor was quite easy. And that came to railway also very fast. And earlier, railways used DC motors. Even now, WDM2 must be plying, and this motor must be there. And you people must be handling it and expert in 165 M motors. So I hello. And but the human beings are human beings. They are never content with anything. So once DC is developed, motors are running, the trains are running. Then the three-phase power got developed in the world in 1890, as I said. And three-phase power became very popular because the voltage could be increased. Transformer is possible, so voltage could be increased. So that became very popular in the industry. And because it was very popular there, the railway people also copied it here. And the three-phase motors, they came to the railways. Don't know why it is not going. slide is not moving. Let me see why it is not moving. I think it has come. The first proper use of traction motor was made in 1896. And why three phase motor came? Because three phase motor was light in construction, eliminated the commutator, needed less maintenance, and regeneration was possible. These were the advantages which were quoted back then. Except the regeneration, everything else is applicable to the diesel locomotives. It was light and commutator is not needed, maintenance is less. You people must have maintained 165 m, the DC motor. And there must be other locos also where a DC motor is used. And the problem of DC, the commutator, must have been faced by all of you. But over a period of time, when the Kapton came and Nomex Mica came, the problem of antique welding, the commutator did not give much of a problem, and still we are that psychologically we are thinking that commutator is giving a problem, and therefore we also started thinking of a three phase motor to give these advantages which were there in historically, and we talk of these same very same advantages even today. But the three phase traction motor on railways is not connected with diesel, but I am just sharing it for your information. It needed three wires, three phase with three wires. So the pentagraph was, you can see there are three wires here on the top. You can't see them clearly, but you can see there are three pentagraphs here and three wires. Now you can imagine the situation at the points and crossing, how the train will cross, a lot of problems. So this became very, very difficult. So they simultaneously started thinking that why not increase the HVDC. So earlier voltage was 620, then 650, then 750 DC, then 1500 volt DC, then 3000 volt DC. These last two voltages, 1500 volt DC and 3000 volt DC, we have used in India, 3000 in Calcutta, 1500 in Bombay area. So we have been using it till recently, and up to 57 we are using 3000 volt DC in Calcutta area. But increasing the DC voltage beyond 3000 volts is not possible or difficult. That is what they think. But now even 400 kV DC is possible, they're transmitting the voltage. So maybe the thinking changes always. So the solid state electronics got developed in 1970. And because now it was possible to get three phase from the DC supply, the three phase motor was again possible to be used for the railways, and it made its appearance. This we saw. Now DC series motor, why we should know, I am sure all of you know it, but I am just repeating whatever you already know. DC series motor is really a unique motor for railway application. It's like we say made for each other, something like that. So this motor ideally suits the traction requirement, and when we talk of three phase, we have to ensure that the characteristic of this motor are somehow copied in the new design, and as per the design of God, that is not possible. So it is made possible by use of the processor computer. For the DC series motor or DC motors, as we call them on railways, knowledge of computer or use of computer is not required. You can straightway use it. But the three phase motor, because it has to do many, many things, which is humanly not possible, it has only the computer can do it. So the use of computer, a processor, is a must here. Without that, it cannot use. If you have seen the DC series motor, there is a field winding on the top. The same current goes into the armature through the brushes. It goes there. The current in the field and the current in the armature, it is same because they are in series. The flux is produced by the current which is flowing through the field coil, which is same as armature current. Now torque is proportional to phi into I. Phi is what? Flux. I is the armature current. So phi and I, they are proportional to each other. So T, the torque, will be proportional to I square, at square of the current. That means the torque will vary more than the current. That's why the starting torque for the DC series motor will be high. I'll show you the sketch here. You can see the starting torque is high here. This is the torque. You can see the torque. Speed is low, but torque is very high. And you can see this shape of this curve like this. So the torque of a series motor is high at the beginning. As we know that the static friction is more than the rolling friction, so we require more torque at the beginning. And later on, we'll see the comparison of torques of various types of motors. And there you'll notice that the DC series motor has got really excellent characteristic as far as the traction applications are concerned. Now this last line is of course not relevant for the diesel traction, but supposing for you have to you get posted for the EMUs, then you may remember this. Now the see the variation in diameter. Actually this I have this shape I have made into this shape just for the giving some distance here. Otherwise, if we take this, and if there's a small variation diameter here, you bring it here and then drop on the x-axis. If there is a small variation in diameter, speeds will vary marginally and the current will vary marginally. That is what we want. Because you know, whatever we may do in the workshop, we cannot ensure that the wheel diameters will be same. It's not possible because wheels will go from one loco to another loco, or middle wheel will get worn off more, one side will get more worn out. So the equality of diameters in locomotive is not possible. Some minor variation will be there. So this, if there is a minor variation, torque or the current variation is also less, which is what we want. This does not happen for the shunt motor, and let me tell you, the induction motor is also having a shunt characteristic. It is like this. If you turn this graph, so it will be straight line like this, and if you draw a line from here, one small variation in diameter, one will hit here, other will hit here, so the variation in current will be very high. So if you use the shunt motor, if you are to use the shunt motor, the variation in the current will be very high if the diameters vary marginally. So these are the two main characteristics which make this motor suitable for railway application. Others are also there, but you can just forget about them. These two, if you remember, and how the computer or the three-phase technology has overcome these problems, or tried to overcome, they have not overcome, they have tried to overcome. that we'll see when we go to the three phase motor. This is for the locos. Direct current motor is not subject to the limitation of transformer. Whatever may be the size of transformer, it works. In series motor, speed automatically decreases as the torque increases. That is because of the this characteristic. Torque increases because it is a hyperbolic, it will automatically happen. It is self-relieving, as we say. And because the current variation is large, not large, if the diameters vary, the parallel running is possible, and that's what we want. On one bogie, we are having motors, another one, we want to run them parallel, a group of two. That is possible in series motor. And therefore, the DC series motor suits the railway application. This is the major drawback of this motor. The only major drawback being the presence of commutator and the brushes. They give a lot of problems. I am showing one diagram here, that is the three phase. I am sure all of you are aware of this three phase, but once I was in Irimi, so somebody had asked me this question, so I have incorporated this. These are how is three phase? There's a very, very fundamental question. So these are the three phases, and this is a neutral point, and it's connected here. So this, if this is a generator, then this is going to the motor, and the motor will produce a torque. When we see the inverter, kindly remember this, or we can come back to this figure. From this, if you take one phase and neutral, you get a figure like this. Now, this is the equivalent circuit of induction motor. You can see this is the stator, R1, X1. In series with that is X2 dash, the reactance of the rotor. R2 dash is resistance of the rotor. One refers to stator, two refers to rotor, and dash refer to reflected on the primary side, so that you can join it here. And this is the magnetizing circuit. Now you can see that this, as if it is a separate part of the motor, but as we know that this is not a separate part, it is inbuilt part of that. The magnetizing circuit and this circuit and the stator circuit, everything is same, but we have shown it like this. This is the way it is shown. So if you understand this circuit, we same as the transformer circuit, then understanding the induction motor is easy. And please remember, the three phase traction motor is same like the normal induction motor which is used in the industry. So understanding of the normal induction motor is helpful to understand the traction motors, because the variation is made because of the power supply. This is same. It gets affected because of the variation in the voltage, frequency, etc. Otherwise, this as such basically remains same. R2 dash is shown as a variable here. R2 dash by S becomes a mechanical load. But it's possible to draw equivalent circuit also by having here S is here, R2 here. That's also possible. It makes really no difference. If you apply the voltage, then the motor will start rotating and it will develop a torque. We saw the characteristic of a DC motor. This is the only characteristic for the induction motor. I have shown it little higher, but it should be little down. So you can see it here. So this is the torque. This is the slip. Slip, I take it that you understand it. What is the synchronous speed? That is maximum possible speed which it can theoretically achieve. And the that is ns minus n, the actual speed divided by ns multiplied by 100, that gives s. So this is s. So which will is obvious that the slip will be 1 here and it will be 0 here because it is running at the synchronous speed. So ns minus n here will be 0. So it like other way around. The speed is increasing like this, but the slip will go like this. 0 is here and 1 is here. And these are the various types of torques are given here. This is the same graph which I have shown. This is known as locked rotor torque. That is the maximum torque which it can produce at the time of start. So supposing we were to use the motor straightway, induction motor straightway, then the starting torque should not be more than this. May be able to develop much more, but to start with, it cannot be more than this, otherwise the motor cannot start. So this is known as locked rotor torque. Then this is known as pull-up torque because it will go down and then pulls up. Then this is known as breakdown torque or the maximum torque. And this is the curve for the low torque. And it meets the torque curve at this point, known as the operating torque. At this point, the torque produced by the motor and the anti-torque because of the load, they match. So the motor will run at this particular point. If you drop the vertical from here, this will be the slip at which the motor will run. And we want it to be as low as possible so that the efficiency is higher. So this is the low torque I said. Now let me go back here. Okay, here you see this is the torque developed by the motor and this is the load torque. This is consumed by the load below the load torque, whatever is there. This torque is consumed by the motor by the load, and this is the surplus torque available for the acceleration. So when the motor accelerates, if a margin is available here, then it will more margin, then it will accelerate fast. If it is very close to this curve, then it will take more time to start. So that we should know that the surplus torque should be more so that the acceleration, when somebody says the acceleration of this motor is quick, that means more margin is available here. One more point here is the breakdown torque. Even if marginally, in a fraction of a unit, if it is exceeded here, the load torque, if it is 100 here, you make 101, load torque as 101, it stop. This important point for the while using the three-phase motor, that if the motor is overloaded, it will stop for immediately. For no reason it will stop. But the other point to note is that once that load is removed, the motor will again start normally. This will happen, or this can happen at the breakdown site. Some trains are stranded and a train is running, and then you attach another train to it and it is moved. So that time the torque may exceed this may exceed this. The load torque may exceed and it can stop there, but nothing to worry. You just take it to just detach the load and it will move. It does not happen in DC motors. If this exceeds, then also it will draw some heavy current, and till the motor gets burned, it will run. Here it will not happen that way, it will just stop. Now you can see the induction motor's characteristic. Motor is nothing but a transformer shorted, secondary shorted. So if it is open, then current will not flow. If it is closed like this, then the current will flow. And our induction motor, the rotor is shorted on itself by a ring. So in induction motor, this circuit is always closed. It doesn't happen in transformer because you have to put a load. This is a very standard question which you can ask to the supervisor when you are testing. I used to do that. Very funny question, because these values are, the resistance value is very small. Supposing this is not connected, the secondary side is open, you apply full voltage, this is less, R is less, you say as per the Ohm's law, V by R, because this is not there, V by R1 should be very high because R1 is very small. But it does not happen. You ask this question and people will get tripped, particularly the new entrant. You can ask them, and this you can have check their knowledge this way. I said this synchronous speed of the motor was ns2. Find out the slip, we say ns minus the actual speed divided by again ns, the synchronous speed, and you get the slip. So that is, this is how the ns is found out. And n is actually, you measure it by tachometer, 120 f by p. You can observe that f, when you are using a motor in industry, the industrial frequency is always 650 cycles. P, number of poles in a motor, induction motor, there are no poles, but pole formation takes place as per the winding. So the number of poles are fixed. 120 is fixed, F is fixed, P is fixed, that means NS is fixed. So in induction motor, normal induction motor, the synchronous speed is always fixed. So a two pole motor is 3000, four pole motor is 1500 RPM. So that is always fixed, it cannot vary, which we do not want in relays because we want speed from zero to maximum. That has to, that change, that control is required, otherwise it cannot work. Torque T is equal to C2 square R2 upon R2 square plus S. This equation will derive, and I had requested professor to come with paper and pencil. I don't want to make the college student out of you, but when you are talking on the wave like this, I am not able to write on the board. Normally I used to write it on board when I'm teaching, but now I'm not able to write, so I request you people to write down. As an induction motor draws 6 to 7 times the rated current at the start. 7 means what? I square R will be how much? 50 times. It gets heated 50 times when you are starting an induction motor. This assumes that the full voltage is applied. Then it will draw 7 times the current, and possibly it can damage the motor if it is not equipped to handle that load. Now, just think of the traction motor. If it is going to draw 7 times the current, the loco is going to get damaged. So this 6 to 7 times the rated current is when full voltage is applied. So what is done in three phase is reduce the voltage. That's why variable voltage, VV, is variable voltage. And we want more speed, so change the F also. So variable voltage VV, variable frequency VF, VV, VF. That is the technology we will use. Starting torque is about half the maximum torque. Torque, actually this point is little less here. This is about whatever is the maximum torque. The starting torque is, it can produce only about half. And parallel operation of motor is not possible. Supposing you connect these motors, this industrial motor for as a traction motors on two sets of wheels. If the wheel diameters are not exactly same, the current drawn will be different. And if even if a marginal difference is there, the current can be very high. And if you can tolerate that difference, then you can use these motors. But if you cannot, then you cannot use this motor unless the three-phase technology, as we are will see now, that is used, you cannot use the motor straight away. The wheel diameters are needed to be almost equal. On railways, I remember the values, correct me if I am wrong. The difference between the wheels on the same axle will be 2 millimeter, within the bogie 5, and between different book is 15 hours. These were the limits I remember. But they were decided from the point of view of the derailment of a locomotive. It should work safely and not from the operation of the three-phase motors. Someday we'll have to take a call on this, the how to adjust the wheel diameter to suit the three-phase traction motors. I told you that I will compare the various torques of the various motors. These are the starting torque. You can see the DC motor starting torque is DC shunt motor. It is 2 times the T. DC series motor is, it is a normal torque. It is normal. So whatever is the normal torque, it produces 3 times of that it can produce at the start. Squirrel cage induction motor, which we are just now discussing, is about T. VVF motor is also T. Slip ring induction is 2.5 times T. Single phase AC is 3 T. Triple shunt is 3. These are all theoretical. What we are interested in this 3 T and this T induction motor. So we have to compare this and this. If it is only T as compared to 3 T here, what do you do? Simple, you design this T in such a way that it is good enough for starting. That means you make a motor bigger so that it can start the load. Once it is able to start it, then there is no problem. It's not that 3T and T are it is normal torque as compared to that, but normally it will also remain as T here. And then you can see the starting currents. This squirrel cage induction motor is 6 to 7 times the starting current, the normal current here. Here the normal current times 2 is, these are the currents here. V by F motor is speciality that it draws only the rated current because the control of the voltage and frequency in such a way that it produces or is allowed to draw only a rated current. Of course, it affects the torque, but we design the motor or use the motor so that it is good enough for the loads for which we are having in mind. Now let us go to the main topic of today, that is three-phase drive. But whatever we just now discussed, that we have to keep in mind always, because it will be useful always. This is the power supply. In locomotive, it will come from the OHE. In the diesel loco, there's a generator there, so it comes from there. And then you convert it here. This is a DC link, and there's an inverter here. And then this supply is given to this motor. This small tiny thing which I have shown is the motor which you have been talking now. So, whatever characteristic of the induction motor we have seen so far are applicable to this motor, the normal induction motor, and this motor, the characteristic will be same. Only small difference I would like to point out is the capacitance. Value of the capacitance is for electric loco, it is 815 microfarad for a voltage of 2800 volt DC, DC link voltage. This voltage is 2800 volt, and for the similar, almost same voltage, 3000 to 2600 volt DC, the value of diesel, the value of capacitor for diesel is 4400 microfarad, almost 5 times. The reason we'll see it, but I think one thing I missed, let me go back. That was this torque. Here, this torque. Here. No, not here. Here. If V is the voltage here, after this drop here, whatever is available is E1. And on this side is E2. So rotor is getting the voltage as E2. And when it is rotated, in the standstill condition, it will be E2. When it is rotating, it will be S times E2. S is the slip. Now this you people can write down so that it becomes little easy to understand. Okay, I say slowly so you can write down. Torque is nothing but point to current. Power, if it is known, power is known. From power we can work out the torque. So what is the power drawn by here is E2. This side is E2. E2 is the voltage applied to the rotor. And what is the current flowing? E2. Write down E2 is the voltage applied. I'll speak slowly here. And I2 is the current. So power to the rotor will be E2 into I2. That is the power. Okay, I hope I'm not fast. And what is the current? E2 I2 is the power. I2 will be the voltage inside the rotor once it's supplied with SE2. So the current drawn will be S into E2 upon Z2. Z2 is the impedance. What is Z2? Is the under root of R2 square plus X2 square. Dash vanishes because it is on the other side only. If you bring it here, or mathematically, and then in dash. So root of R2 square plus S times X2 square, that is under root of that is Z2. So current will be SE2 upon Z2. Z2 is R2 square plus SX2 square, root of that. So the power will be E2 into SE2 upon root of R2 square plus SX2 square, under root of that, multiplied by power factor. And power factor is nothing but R2 upon under root of R2 plus SX2 square. So PF is R2 divided by R2 square plus SX2 square, root of that. That is Z2. So the power will be E2 I2 into cos phi. E2 is E2, I2 is SE2 divided by under root of R2 square plus SX2 square, both square, multiplied by power factor, which is R2 upon root of R2 square plus SX2 square. And the रूट ऑफ आर टू स्क्वायर प्लस एस एक्स टू स्क्वायर मल्टीप्लाइड बाय रूट ऑफ आर टू स्क्वायर प्लस एस एक्स टू स्क्वायर विल बिकम आर टू स्क्वायर बाय आर टू स्क्वायर प्लस एस स्क्वायर एक्स टू स्क्वायर एंड देयर फॉर द पावर विल बी इक्वल टू एस ई टू स्क्वायर आर टू अपॉन आर टू स्क्वायर प्लस एस स्क्वायर एक्स टू स्क्वायर. आई होप यू पीपल हैव अंडरस्टूड. एंड supposing the motor is running at synchronous speed, doesn't happen, but theoretically it's running that, then this will become the torque itself. So T will be equal to S E2 square R2 upon R2 square plus S square X2 square. Now differentiate this with respect to S, slip. Many things are constant. E2 is constant, R2 is constant, and what you get? Hello, hello. Okay, and what you get is R2 will be equal to S X2. That's what you get. That means S will be equal to R2 by X2. So if you come here, the S corresponding to this. If this is a slip, R2 is equal to SX2, what we said. If this is the slip here, then you get the maximum torque at no other place except this. But you can observe that this point, if you observe, this is about 0.5S, which means the motor will run very inefficiently. It will heat and a lot of power will be wasted, so we run somewhere here, try to run it here. So it doesn't produce maximum torque, but it runs efficiently. I will be sharing this. I think Professor Das is already having this PowerPoint presentation, so you can get this, whatever I have said it. I think this is not there, but if required I can write down and send it to you. Okay. Let us go to. We saw this, and we can see here that the difference between diesel and electric is only that power is coming from here, which means in regeneration, the whatever regenerated power that has to be wasted, so we call it dynamic braking. Generated here and supplied to the resistance and gets wasted. We are more interested in controlling the speed of the train than saving the power. Here you, obviously you cannot get back diesel from whatever energy we already produce. One thing we should know from the knowledge of DC motor, that DC motor requires a field so that the magnetic energy is supplied and that flux is cut by the conductors and the energy is produced. Now that is not possible in the induction motor. Induction motor, only three wires go there. And that's all. This rotor is not at all connected, but still magnetic circuit is required. So that is produced by this itself. This is the power. It carries the power into the rotor, and also the power is supplied by these wires to the stator, which produces the magnetic field required. And please remember that this power is not small. It is about 30% of the total power, this magnetic power. So it has to come from this source only. But when we are braking, that time you cannot supply power here because you are stopping the motor. You are applying brake. Dynamic braking is a different thing. But when you are stopping it, obviously no power can go here. It is disconnected from here. But still the power is required, so the कैपेसिटर सप्लाई द पावर हियर, द कैपेसिटर स्टोर्स गुड अमाउंट ऑफ एनर्जी, इट इज हाफ सीवी स्क्वायर, सो वी इज क्वाइट हाई एंड हियर एज कम्पेयर टू एसी लोकोमोटिव इट इज 5 टाइम्स मोर, सो गुड अमाउंट ऑफ पावर इज स्टोर्ड हियर. सो आई थिंक इंस्ट्रक्शन मस्ट बी देयर फॉर यू पीपल टू टेक गुड केयर ऑफ दिस कैपेसिटर बिकॉज इट विल बी डेंजरस, कैरी लॉट ऑफ पावर, सो प्रोबली यू हैव टू डिस्चार्ज दिस बिफोर केयरफुली एंड देन ओनली यू कैन वर्क हियर इन दिस सर्किट, अदरवाइज the capacitor power remains there only. The loco is stopped and it cannot flow here because it's stopped. It cannot go back, it cannot go anywhere, so the power will remain here. So you will have to take due precaution to ensure that the capacitors are discharged and then only you can use it. As I said that motor DC motor requires field. The field is it is in X axis. The current flow, armature flow, is in the on the Y axis. Can you imagine? Flux is coming from a side, and the current is flowing from the other side, and that's why the interaction takes place. So this is known as DQ axis, and this DQ axis theory is somehow replicated in 3-phase motor also. That we'll see. It is difficult to imagine because this only 3 wires are going there, and from these three to make two fields at right angle to each other looks difficult but possible. One more thing I would like to remind you people. The voltage equation for the DC is phi P Zn upon 120A. Phi is the flux, P is number of poles, P is number of poles, Z is number of conductors, N is RPM, and 120A is the parallel path. And for the AC, it is 4.445 F. Which means it is the voltage which decides the frequency in is the frequency the rotation RPM which decide the amount of voltage generated and not vice versa. But you will see now for the 3-phase, it is not the frequency which decide the voltage, but voltage in a way decide the frequency. Component we have seen components of 3-phase drive, transformer or generator, transformer and DC in loco and generator here, line converter, DC link, capacitor, inverter. These are the parts of the 3-phase drive. DC links for electric loco, diesel loco, and EMUs are same with minor variation is only the capacitor. And the other is the dynamic braking. You have an arrangement to waste the energy. In electric locomotive, the energy is taken out and fed to the OHE. So this only very small difference, otherwise, they are same. Diesel loco get the power from the generator and EMU and electric get from the transformer. The capacitor of diesel loco is higher in size, I just now said. During dynamic braking, the magnetizing current is provided by the capacitor in diesel loco. Without magnetizing current, the dynamic braking or regenerative braking is not possible. Motoring is possible because when it is motoring, current is coming from that, it can take out the current required for the magnetizing. And magnetizing current is about 30 to 30-35% of the total current. आई विल शो यू दी सिंगल, आई वॉज नॉट एबल टू कॉपी दिस, दिस माई बुक, आई एम गोइंग टू शेयर इट विथ प्रोफेसर दास. वन फिगर फ्रॉम हियर आई वॉज नॉट एबल टू लिफ्ट, शो यू, कैन यू सी दिस, आई होप यू कैन सी इट. दिस अ सिंगल फेज, दिस अ सिंगल फेज कन्वर्टर. फ्रॉम द डीसी लिंक इट इज दीज आर दी क्यू वन क्यू टू की थ्री की फोर. सो वेन दिस टू आर ऑन द पावर विल फ्लो फ्रॉम राइट लेफ्ट टू राइट ऑफ दिस लोड. एंड वेन दी दिस टू आर ऑन पावर विल फ्लो from right to left. So the power flows like this, and power second time it flows like this, like this, like this, like this, like this. That's the AC. The single phase inverter is you can readily understand how the DC becomes AC. But unfortunately, this figure, I think some virus has gone into it in the my PDF. From there, I was not able to extract. But in the book it is there, and hopefully all of you will get these books and you can see it. It is easy to understand the single phase inverter. So you can see it. It is on page 61. And this is the DC link. And you can see capacitors are for filtration here. You can see this, and these are the IGBTs. This one, this three, 1, 2, 3 here, top, 1, 2, 3 on the bottom. So supposing this is closed, the current can flow from here, here, here. And this is a load, this is a traction motor. So it can flow from here, can go here, and it's from here it will go here, it will go here, it will go back to negative, positive, negative. So current started from positive, it's traveled like this, like this, like this, gone to negative. At the same time, current can also flow like this, like this, like this, like this. From this again, this. Now imagine, recall the three vectors R, Y, B. If the one volt vector, say R, is on the positive Y axis, then that means it is having maximum voltage, full voltage. The other two will be 30 degree below the x-axis, so they will produce about half the voltage, half, exactly half. So the balancing is top side is V, other side is V by 2, V by 2. So that is how the voltage balance takes place. When the whole vectors rotate as per the or sine function, sine cosine is same. The voltage will vary. 90 degree cos will be 0. Come to the x axis, it will be maximum. And that is how the voltage variation takes place. So, in our normal supply, the voltage varies as per that. The supply available in such a way that these vectors vary sinusoidally. You apply the load to it, the current flowing through it will also be sinusoidal. You apply, because V resistance is R, so V by R is the current. So if V is sinusoidal, current will be also sinusoidal. But in this case, it is the current which is made to flow. It is adjusted in such a way that it varies from 0 to maximum here, same time with separation of 120 degree, whatever is the value, this will vary, and further 120 degree, 240 degree, whatever is the current, it is made to vary in this. So it is a current which is made to vary by the pulsation of the closing this timing of this, close it, close it, close it, in such a way that this current which will flow here will be in similar to what the if the it was drawing from the normal three phase supply. Whatever, supposing we apply a normal supply here, the current flowing here, and we are using a three phase, whatever current will flow there after that, they should be same. That means it is not the voltage which is causing the current, but the type of current which amount, way the current is flowing, it will amount that it is the voltage applied is sinusoidally. And this voltage is made to vary by switching on, switching off, switching off, switch off of this IGBTs in such a way that you get the required amount of current flow in the load. You can understand if there is a mistake here, this is closed at the same time, this also gets closed, what happens? There's a dead short here directly, or this, or this, or this, anyway. So this is very important that they should behave properly. The this, if it is having a current here, then this should open out first, then this close for the second operation. Otherwise, there can be a problem. And in fact, these problems are there. That's why the inverters give problem, only because of this. And this capacitor also can malfunction, or this diode can also malfunction. So we say that the induction motor, the three-phase motor, is free of commutation problem, commutator problem. But the problems of the commutator are really passed on to the inverter here, and we consider them as a separate problem apart from the motor. But if you are comparing the DC series motor with the three phase motor, then actually they should be considered as the same problems of the motors only. So I had shown you the voltage equation of the motor as V equal to 4.445 ft. That's the equation for the, that means if you rotate the armature more, voltage developed will be more. That is the F. If you increase F, then voltage gets increased more. Here the voltage does not increase because of the frequency, it is the rate at which these are the clues, and that's how it is producing the voltage. Voltage is actually the indirectly proportional to this current flowing. But we have to understand that frequency, what is not producing the voltage, is present there, because without frequency and without flux, the voltage cannot be there. So that flux is here. There is no flux here which is cutting it. It is already cut by the generator in the generating station. In this diesel loco, it is in the generator itself. Okay. Now let us see the power supply. In this motor, these inverters, they give a feeling that they are more powerful than the DC motors. I give you the example of EMU just for understanding. It was 183 kW motor, and for three phase it was replaced with 220 kW. But output is same. WAG9, it's 850 kW, and motor in WAG7, this is DC, is 670. In fact, this gives more output. The trailing load of this WHG7 is more. Why it happening like that? No magic, no power is getting wasted. Now if you go back to the induction motor, what is the power here? If this is the voltage here between this and this is V, current is I, then the power drawn by this motor, if the supply is the normal supply from the industry, it will be root 3 V into I cos phi. So assume that it is unity. So it is root 3 into V to I cos phi is 1. But here, what is supply here? This voltage can be maximum. If this is V, this will be maximum V by 2. So this is V by 2. This is another V by 2. This is V by 2. And this is V by 2. So this is V by 2 and V by 2. It cannot become 1.73 V by 2. It can become only V. So 0.5 V, 0.5 V and 0.5 V multiplied by 1.5 VI. Only that much power is available. But conventionally we consider this 1.732. So they have considered this. People, they give us cell talks because everybody believes that it is 1.7 root 3 VI. That we believe. But it is less than that. It is 1.5 VI. This should be VI and not 1.732 VI. So if you take the ratio of that, it is 1.15. So this power, if you see the ratio, this will almost match. They will almost match, but still it is little more because this is little more, AC is little more because the AC motor gets heated up due to harmonics. A lot of harmonics are there. Any electronics, use of electronics to produce the DC or AC means lot of harmonics. So those harmonics, they produce heat, and that heat has to be dissipated. So if the motor is of say diameter D, then you make it bigger, say 15%, 20% more, so that it is able to dissipate more heat. So we cannot cool it specially, but you can make it bigger so that it has got a more area. So you make it bigger, so capacity wise you make it little more, so the it can dissipate it efficiently and keep the temperature rise within the limit. So one thing is about this 1.5, we take it as 1.732, and on the top of that we require something more to dissipate the heat. So these motors are more, appear more, but the hauling capacity, you can see in the logo trailing books, it is less. I checked up for the diesel locomotive. I think they are only extrapolated or from mathematically they have done it. It should be in the same way. The hauling capacity of the AC locomotive, if it is more, then that motor has to be very, very powerful. And if the same motors are used, then the capacity of the hauling capacity of the DC should be better. Okay. We talk about the power factor. Power factor for diesel, it's not that important. For electric, it is important. First, let us see how it is made as unity. We always say that in three-phase technology, we can make it unity. And how it affects the diesel, that also we'll see. Now, this is the reactance. This is the stator, secondary side. This is reactance and this is the converter. Now, if this is connected across the converter, then the secondary voltage will be equal to the reactance voltage plus the converter voltage. Secondary voltage will be equal to converter voltage plus reactance voltage. This is the same voltage. So this is the vector sum here. Now by adjusting the converter voltage, this if you bring it here halfway, then this will become like this, and this angle will become like this. Here it is shown in phase here, but supposing it is here, the reactance voltage will become like this, and it has to be this has to be at quadrature, so it will become like this. So by just to illustrate that, by adjusting the converter voltage, this voltage, this ES is remaining same, this can be changed, and therefore because this is in quadrature to this at right angle, this angle gets changed. So variation of converter voltage affects the angle AC here, and that's why it is possible to make the power factor as unity in case of a three-phase drive. But what will happen, supposing we electric locomotive, easy to understand, if we make it unity for the regenerative braking, what happens? We are making this by adjusting this, that means whatever power is inside the rotor, we are not taking out fully, or if it has come out partially and then we switch off, make the power factor as unity, then the power will remain there only. If the power remains inside the rotor, it will take more time to slow down. Then you have to apply mechanical brakes or something. So as we say in the pulleys or something, that whatever, or levers, whatever is gained in speed is lost in distance. So whatever you, nothing is free in the world. So if you are getting this improvement here, PF, you are losing somewhere. For the diesel, also this will be there, I think it is there. So if you are using this, what will happen? The power which is there inside the rotor will also remain here only. On the supply side, there is no question of making any power factor improvement because the generation is within that only. So if you use it, it is a part of the three-phase drive, so it will be there. So by using, you can make the power factor better. This must be a sell talks. The people who are selling the technology, they will say that we can make a power factor as unity. Yes, it is possible, but then the braking time will go. Now we talk about four quadrant operation. Three-phase technology is just so many words, just to probably to confuse the people. Four quadrant is nothing but this. This technology, these curves, which are nothing but the curves which we saw here. This curve, this is one, and if you have it on the in the reverse direction, if you run, it will be like it's a mirror image of that. And if you make the motor to work as generator, then it will be running in the other direction. Then you supply the power to the motor, then it will run in this direction. In industry, it is not possible to supply power to the motor, but in railways, it is possible. You just switch off the supply, and the load will drive the motor, and then it will regenerate. And you can see the plugging here. Plugging is a method of it's like a dynamic braking. You just waste the energy in the resistance. It is relevant in the electric locos. Diesel locomotives, it is dynamic, so everything is like plugging only. Plugging is a reversing actually. You are RYB is there. And RYB, you just you just reverse it. The supply comes from OHE. If it is RYB going, then you make it RBY. So motor will start running in a opposite direction. And once it is running in opposite direction, it will amount to braking. But if you continue the plugging for more time, then actually the train will start running in the opposite direction. So at the exact time, it has to be reverse. So when we are having the DC traction earlier days, the old technology, plugging was theoretically possible, but actually not possible because that instant of reversal was not known. Otherwise, the train would have gone back only. But here, because we are using the computer, it is possible to know exactly at what time we can stop. So plugging can be stopped and we can go into the dynamic braking mode for the electric locomotive. For your operation, it is dynamic braking. State goes to the dynamic braking and you can go for the braking. So four quadrant is motoring operation one, then also a motoring operation in the reverse direction. This is forward, this is reverse, and this is the generation operation, dynamic braking, generation operation. Generation, it is dynamic braking, actually it generates power. So this is the operation. So one, two, three, and four, that's why it's four quadrant. Otherwise, it is nothing really. People get really confused what is four quadrant. This is how the flux, the voltage is varied. If this is the torque speed or torque slip characteristic for a particular frequency. If we have a number of frequencies, then the characteristic will change like this. Change the frequency and this shape will be altered like this. So from this itself, if you supply, this is the motor characteristic, supply a variable frequency voltage to the motor, then this will change and change in a way. Change in this way. So you can see one curve like this, another curve like this, third curve like that. And you join this point from here. If it comes here, then immediately change the frequency, go to the higher one, go here, third one like that. And then you join these points, then you get our normal curve. This curve you get, this torque speed curve of the three phase drive. So these points have been joined here, and these points have been joined here. So this is known as constant torque. This is a corner point, which is it can satisfy constant torque as well as constant power mode, and this is the constant power mode. As you increase the frequency beyond the corner point, it's known as base frequency or base speed. You increase it, then the torque drops, but power remains same. How much time is more, Professor Das? Hello? Hello?
सर लगभग आधा घंटा बाकी है। हाँ
So I think they can take a break for 2 minutes or 5 minutes. Come back. In 5 minutes, they can come back. Hello? Hello?
ओके
Five
सर
Five. राइट सर
20 मिनट्स ही रिवेंट सर विल टेक 5 मिनट ब्रेक
ओके ओके आई ट्राई टू बी Try to be brief now. But if I extend by 5-10 minutes, will it be okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. I think the participants should agree. The senior officers are there, I heard.
Okay, sir.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, sir. You're audible, sir.
Can I start now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So you can see, this is the various types of curves we get in the VVF control. You can see the motor torque remain constant here, then it drops down in the constant power region. See the rotor current, how it behaves, how the slip is going like this. The slip is like this, and this is slip frequency like this. How it happens, we'll just see now. Constant torque. Power is equal to V into I, that we all know, into is equal to the speed, RPM into T, into some constant, 2 pi n T upon 4500 and all. So I am taking it as K. So T will be equal to VI upon KN. And in this case, I is constant. I is constant. And n equal to 120 f by p, we saw that p is fixed and v by f is kept constant. V by f is kept constant, so t will be constant, everything remains constant only. So what the processor has to do is change the voltage, change the frequency in such a way that v by f remains constant. If that is done, then the torque will remain constant, which is the torque will remain constant. If we keep V by F constant, nothing more has to be done. The change the voltage, but and change the frequency so that the V by F remains constant. At the beginning, because the motor has to start and it has to overcome some impedance and all, so more voltage is applied in the beginning, and then the variation is nominal. this is the constant torque, and the constant power. Only one thing which probably you people may not know, with frequency the resistance goes up, because the current tries to flow towards the periphery, and inside is only nothing is there. So less area is available for the foil, the resistance goes up, but the reactance goes down if the frequency goes up. So these are the two opposing characters which I have given in the my book, which are based on the book of M.G. Sales, a very standard book. So from there I have taken that. So now current I will be equal to V upon 2 pi FL. FL is the reactance, and FL is kept constant, F into L, we saw that. If processor is ensuring that I will be kept constant, F is going up, you are increasing, and L is coming down. V by A, we are increasing the whole frequency, voltage cannot increase, is fixed. But F we are increasing, and L is falling down as we increase the frequency. In such a way we have to fall down that this product is kept constant. If that is kept constant, then the I will be constant. If I is constant, V is constant, so V into I is equal to power is constant. So power is constant, power will be maintained. So all this is manually is not possible. It is only the processor which can do it. And these are the various ways in which the voltages are varied. Can vary from here, little bit of add here, and then increase like this. These are the given in the IEC. These are can go up to here and change like this, or go like this. These are the three accepted way in which the voltage can be varied as per the IEC. Scalar control. We talk about, I said no, these are the jugglers, jargons which are used in three-phase drive. One was that four quadrant. Then scalar control, vector control. Now AC quantities are considered as just numbers, and if they only the magnitudes are considered for the change of speed of induction motor, voltage can be changed disregard to the angle between the voltage and current. Is the electrical quantities, you know it, that there is some angle between the voltage and current. Forget that angle, only the magnitude. So if you only change the take only the magnitudes into consideration, then that whatever is the control is known as scalar control. You only get a feedback of the RPM here, give a correction signal, and then that's the ultimate motor work. Simple. Vector control. But in railways, we say that torque is more important than the speed, and therefore we must get whatever torque we want, we should get it, and then whatever is the corresponding speed is okay for us. So torque is more important, and then speed can be anything corresponding to that torque. That's what we say. But really both are not interchangeable, and I can tell you I have not seen a method. There is no method given in any of the books, any of the standards, IECs, how to check an inverter. If you get an inverter for a locomotive, how do you check it, whether they are provided vector control or scalar controls? Just now you saw that the vector control was simple, just get a feedback from the RPM supply there, and the correction is available. So whatever speed you want, you get it. If it is less than that, then voltage will go up, and then the correction will take place. But in vector control, what we are worried about is the torque. Now, when we are controlling by vector, it should stop precisely at that place. That's what we intend. But if it stops 1 or 2 meter this side, that side, really, neither it is relevant nor it is possible to know whether it has been used. So, my suggestion to you people, when you are buying, when you are in a position to influence the manufacturer, you ask them to give a method to test how we can understand whether what you are giving us is vector control or scalar control. Just because you are saying it is vector control, we pay more money, railway money, and make you rich. That is what they are doing. Okay. In the beginning, I said the field and the current for the DC machines are at the right angle. Field is at the x-axis, and current is supposed to flow in the y direction. So they are at the right angles. Such variation, this flux in one direction, current in that direction, this is achieved by a flux control method, and processor can do it. We'll see a little bit mathematically, but really speaking, it is for the designer. For people like us, the little bit understanding of that is good enough. So these are the various feedbacks we get, and give it here. VD, VQ, and how this VD and VQ that I will show you mathematically, and then give a feedback here. Then corrected signal goes here, and whatever is the input coming from the control will go to the motor, and you get the speed so that we get the desired torque. But as I said, there is no method to know. The simple one which I had shown you on this one, how to know which one has been used? Difficult. If you can demonstrate, give the method to check, then it is possible, but it's not possible. Now let us see the mathematics of a vector control. Actually, we say sinusoidal, but sinusoidal and cosine function, they are one and the same. Shape and everything is same. If you remember the your first year of science college, actually what we get is cos function only, and to make it Lenz's law applicable, we convert this cos into sine. Otherwise, what we get is only cos theta. So supposing the first is I1 cos theta, I2 cos theta. This is 120 degree difference on the minus side, and this is on the add. So these are the three currents. These are the magnitudes of the currents. Now we multiply by this. I1 cos theta we just keep outside, and I2 cos theta minus 2 pi by 3 we multiplied by A bar, which is equal to cos of 2 pi by 3 plus J sine 2 pi by 3. This is done by the processor. And the Euler's equality is ij theta cos theta plus j sin theta. We multiply this by this, and the other one we multiplied by a bar square, which is the complex conjugate of cos of 2 pi by 3 minus j sin 2 pi by 3. We multiply by that. Then these are the three quantities we are adding here, and keeping I1 cos theta aside, the balance of the two terms will become I2 cos theta 2 pi by 3 into a bar square here, and cos of theta minus 2 pi by 3 is equal to minus half cos theta plus root 3 2 sin theta, and cos of theta plus 2 pi by 3 is minus 1 cos of 2 theta minus root 3 by 2 sin theta. Now equation will be simplified as half cos theta plus 3 by 2 sin theta, and adding cos theta which we had kept outside become 3 by 2 cos theta plus j 3 by 2 sine theta. So this is the direct axis and this is quadrature axis. Whatever is associated, the value A, whatever the amount of current, you can multiply here. Here it is assuming that the currents are balanced, that is all three currents are same. And it is the case in locomotives because all three phase currents are always equal. So you multiply that and you get the current. And now this can be controlled independently by the processor. So the three phase is reduced really to the two quantities, the two vectors. And for the motor, we say there are two vectors, one like one at the x axis, other at the right y axis. So this is x axis, this is y axis. And this is how the processor controls. Regeneration or dynamic braking, you can see it takes place like this. The supply is coming like this. It can go either here, DC link, or it can come like this. Both ways it is possible. This is a capacitor is to dynamic. So this is the double way. You can either go from here to here, you can go from here to here, or it can go from a three-phase supply here, or other way around. This is how we use the for the regeneration. Same for the dynamic braking also. I want to show you braking. For the braking is the current, stator current. Now we are braking here and this is a voltage is dropping here. Okay, the voltage is same here, so the current can be like this, but voltage is dropping here and it is going up like this. How it is possible? Because it is going into plugging mode. So do the plugging little bit and at a appropriate time you go for the dynamic braking. So that becomes an efficient way of controlling the motor. Okay, the advantages of this motor, the one is obviously the absence of commutator, and DC series motor, the problem was the wheel slip. Wheel slip doesn't take place in three phase, but slip side does take place. It motor can just slide. So that happens. And that's why if you take the statistics, you will find that the tire turning of this locomotive fitted with this will be more than that to the DC. DC also it was happening, but only because of the wheel. So it was rotating like this, but not the pits were not coming. The regeneration is easily possible in this motor, that is for the locomotive, and high speeds are possible with the higher frequency. This is the great advantage of this motor. High speeds are possible. So for the bullet trains, we can use this motor because you can get a good amount of speed. What you have to only worry about the bearings, otherwise motor is there which can give you the speed which you want. So this is the advantage. Regeneration, of course, for diesel it is immaterial. Commutator, of course, is important. And when you go for the, maybe some of you will work for the bullet trains, remember that this is the same motor, but the frequency range for this motor is higher. But if you have seen it, the torque is much less here when you you can see that the torque will be much less here. The speeds will be very high here. Torque will be less. So bullet trains normally will not have very high load. Few coaches will be there. The initial torque of course will be good, but when it's running, then it is torque will be less, which should not matter for the bullet because the number of coaches will be less. And this we have seen, this we saw. These are the advantages. This I was telling you, this speeds of this motor will be high. Now this motors, not that everything is good, not everything is bad, but everything is not good. The problems are because of the heat generation. Wherever the electronics is used, power electronics is used, there will be harmonics, and harmonics means loss of energy, and loss of energy results into generation of heat. Another problem is the unbalanced magnetic pull. I have got the formula there. If the rotor inside the stator is pulled equally on the top and equally at the bottom, the rotor will remain at the center. But if the pull is unequal, then motor, the shaft gets deflected. That's why if you have seen the electric locomotive, shafts are big, and if the shafts are big, the pinion cannot be big. So the another shaft, pinion shaft is drilled inside and another shaft is pulled. So shaft in shaft and then pinion on the top. Unconventional arrangement. And circulating current in the bearing, pinion and shaft. Because stator can not only induce the current in the rotor, it can induce the current in the shaft and pinion, etc. It can circulate. It doesn't happen in DC because DC there is no induction. But here, because it is induction motor, it induces current in the pinions, shaft also, and shaft current will circulate within the shaft itself. It will flow, and that will create the problem for the bearing. If the current is continues to flow through the bearing, bearing will get damaged. So break the current, then you can use the insulated bearing. The current will break and the bearing will get protected, but still the damage will be on the other side, other bearing. It will get damaged, and if the damage is excessive, then you have to use insulated bearing on the other side. And if you use the insulated bearing on both sides, problem doesn't stop there. The when the current is flowing, the periodically the voltage will get developed, and then the voltage buildup will be so high that it will flash over within the bearing, and the bearing will fail. And that voltage required for this breakdown is about 1 or 2 volts only, so it's very small. So so if problems are coming, then we as a user can hardly do anything. Only the meant the designer will have to be consulted of the bearing as well as the locomotive traction motor to suggest the use of whether they should go for a single insulated bearing or double insulated bearing, or the if it is the capacitor buildup takes place, then how frequently to replace it so that it doesn't fail online. When the heating takes place, the joints in the O-ring portion of the stator coils, non-driving end, there will be joints. So those joints will get opened because of the heating. And so what can be done is provide the better joint. If the there's a overhang, then you try to reduce it. The Kirloskar have done a modification which is really ridiculous. What they have done, they have used the few copper stamping at the end. But if you use the copper stamping, then that much portion, the flux cannot pass because copper is non-magnetic, flux cannot go there. So to that extent, the length of the rotor will be reduced. The power of the motor is given by D square L. D is the diameter and L is the length. So if you are reducing the L, that means you are reducing the power. So no good way of reducing the failure of the O-ring by using the copper stampings. If somebody suggests you that, then probably you can say that no, it's no good. Now the heat generation can also take place. We saw that the torque was proportional to S e to square R2 upon R2 square plus S x2 square. That means R2, x2 are very important for this motor. And if you change it, this was for that particular speed, the base voltage, base frequency. The torque what we derived was for the base voltage, base frequency. But here we are using any number of frequencies, so at least we know that for that it is holding good. So with respect to that, the others are designed. But if your motor fails and you have to rewind it, then please ensure that it goes to the reputed rewinder, or the person, so that he uses the same parameters as the original parameter, or he, at least he should be aware what are the parameters of this R2 X2 for the base frequency, base voltage, what are the values, so that if he uses that, the problem of heating will be reduced. Otherwise we will have a problem. Supposing the person who doesn't understand the implication of resistance, he will use the any type of wire for the winding, rewinding, and then the motor will start giving problem. Also, vibration of course is a problem because of the harmonics, and in addition to the vibration, the converter can also have the problems, which for DC motor we include along with the commutator. Here we don't include in the motor problem, but really speaking, it is the problem of the motor. More harmonic loss than the normal induction motor. Big motors have more loss. For example, hello, nice. Hello. Achha. For example, 30 HP motor with sinusoidal supply has a no load loss of 687.5, and with non sinusoidal supply, that is the inverter supply, it is 77.5 watts more. So the heat generation is necessarily more in the three phase motor. So heating problem has to be there, and it has to be anticipated. And if it is anticipated well by the designer, then nothing can happen. But if not appreciated, then the rotor bar will open. I have seen in Hubli locomotive, these bars were getting opened. So this could be the reason. I don't know whether the problem is overcome now. The tensile strength of the copper drops with the temperature rise, and that's why if the temperature rises there, then it is prone to breakages. Eddy current loss of course will be more because of the we are using higher frequency. Starting current in V by F drive is less. We saw that it was current was not 7 times or 6 times, but it was steady. Whatever was the current remains same, but for the starting the current is more, so duration is more. So I have included in the book the study I carried out on Central Railway. It is more or less same with the induction motor and this motor, where the normal induction motor it is 6 to 7 times. Here it is current is only I, but still because the duration was more, the heating will be same. Duration is more. Unlike DC series motor, these motors work in regeneration, adding to the heat generator, because there we only apply the mechanical brakes. So when we are applying the mechanical brake, the heating is outside the motor. When we are doing the regeneration or the dynamic braking, heating is within the motor because it is electrically braking. UMPI told you, supposing this is the armature or rotor, and this is the stator, and this is G plus X, and this is G minus X. G is the diameter. So you can see that the equation for the force is g upon g minus s, and because the value of this is very small, this is very small, gap is very small. Yeah, this is the gap. It can never be uniform, and on the top of that, if you have a small variation, the force will be very large because of the gap. This g is small, and because it is small, the value of this force is tremendously big. The shaft actually bend if this becomes little more than that, and it can bend a shaft because of the unbalanced magnetic pull. It's a common problem for this motor. In DC motor, it was not there because the gap in this motor is about 2 millimeter for the keeping the power factor better, and in DC it is about 4 to 5 millimeters. There is no question of any air the power factor, and when this G is more, the force is less. It is double or maybe 3 times of the value in AC motor. So this force UMP will be there in DC also, but it will be less, much, so it can be neglected. Here, because of the less air gap, it cannot be neglected, and it can bend the shaft. And when it bends the shaft, then the rotor will start rubbing with the stator, and then thereby causing the failure. You can see the how the time has affected the bearing failure. I got the values from 2004, 5, 5, 6, and 6, 7. You can see the FRPC by 5.6 here, become 9.8, become 18.8. So the with as I said, the voltage buildup when the current is flowing goes on damaging, and as the time progresses, the damage becomes more and more. So single bearing cannot stop it. Then you provide two. Initially, no bearing may be insulated. Then you provide insulated. Then you provide two insulating bearings, and they have to periodically change it by taking the consulting the manufacturer. Other problems: opening up joints in the O-ring portion. We said O-ring harmonic vibration is caused due to harmonics. Converter is a part of motor for comparison with DC motor and has its own problem. To get high starting torque, gear ratio of this motor has to be kept high, and that's why the power has to be more. I don't know how much time is there. If anybody has got questions, you can ask now, or you can tell the Professor Das, then he can pass on the problems to me, and I will reply to them. Professor Das, I will be sending the books to you.
Sir,
if you have the arrangement to distribute, get it distributed from Central Way itself.
Yes, sir. I will get it collected from you, sir. That I am planning, sir. Next week I will contact you, sir.
Whatever. Yes. Okay.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. I hope there are no further questions from any of the participants.
Questions, if they are there, they can raise to you, and then you can pass it on to me. I will reply.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your for taking time out of your schedule educate us about the infrastructure.
I'm honored, actually, Das. You gave me a lot of help yesterday also, today also.
No, sir. It is my duty, sir.
And also, you just have a look at the SFC. Because it is not convincing.
Okay, I will try to check that, sir. Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay.